Hey.
Well, look who's here.
Damn. Hey, you standing.
Hello,
good.
T.
What's that, brother?
I'm standing. Yeah. Heck yeah, I'm standing.
What's that?
Good
What's
to see
on?
You, buddy.
Everything good?
Yeah, things are good. Bring back memories.
Is this the old stadium?
This is where we were. Do you ever?
Wow.
I'm just curious. Do you ever? How often do you think of?
Wait, what?
With you and me.
Man, this is. I try not to think about it, but yesterday everybody in the country, well, that's the only thing they want to know talk about.
Well, I said, people didn't really know who you were until the injury. And then all of a sudden, now you're like, you know, now like everybody, oh, I know, you're the guy that broke Joe's leg.
What do you mean that nobody knew who I was? That don't even make no sense, you know?
You're going to be a football player when you grow up?
Today is the best day of your life. Believe
me. Give me 18 years of daylight. That's all right.
Greatest leader I've ever known.
What a ride it's been.
I love life. I live football vicariously through my life, or my life through football.
I remember we were really playing well.
Yeah, I was playing well. Novo, hey, listen, you understand we were winning at one point, weren't we?
Yes, you were.
We were winning. Yeah,
but you didn't win the game.
We didn't win the game.
You know, it's funny.
Because they brought a real quarterback in.
A younger one.
A younger
one. Always a younger one.
Joe's injury there will be something that a lot of football fans would remember, and it's something that people just don't forget.
And they always remember where they were when they saw it on TV.
You know, I've become somewhat the godfather of broken legs. When somebody breaks a leg, people call me.
The injury was nearly 40 years ago.
Theismann did a lot of clever. And it was Lawrence Taylor who slammed Theismann to the ground. If Theismann is hurt.
And while it may be the first thing that comes to mind when you hear the name Joe Theismann, his career was so much more.
There's certain guys that I think are born to play quarterback, and that's Joe Theismann.
God made him to play football.
He was an All-American at Notre Dame, Washington's all-time passing leader, an NFL MVP, and a Super Bowl champion.
For the first time since 1942, the Washington Redskins have an NFL championship.
We were the best in the NFL, and you got to have a great quarterback to do that, and Joe was that quarterback.
I think he's been overlooked as one of the best quarterbacks to have played in the NFL. Why he's not in the Hall of Fame, I don't know.
You know, Joe was an easy target. You liked him or you didn't like him, and you took a side.
A lot of people misunderstand Joe. They think he's very cocky, but he's not. He's just very confident.
Joe Theismann, the very symbol of this franchise.
Joe Theismann was a star at a time when there were very few national stars in pro football.
Going out for a bat.
All right.
With the AE-1, it's easy to shoot like a pro. The incomparable Canon AE-1.
He was a quarterback for the Redskins in the past two Super Bowls.
And our special guest today, Joe Theismann of the Washington Redskins.
After playing football, he made a career talking about it.
He's always been a showman, and I think he always will.
Joe's always been marketable. He saw himself as being a leading man. As Hollywood as Joe was, he was still a caveman when it came to Sundays.
Say what you will about Joe Theismann, but he is some competitor.
I would do anything I could to help our football team win.
I remember Joe Theismann returning punts when he was a backup quarterback.
I would never, ever cower under the pressure that you go through, whether it be physically or mentally.
Garrett's there, touchdown, Washington Redskins.
I love the game. I love life. I live football vicariously through my life, or my life through football.
All right, let's go to work now.
Theismann's football life began in South River, New Jersey.
It wasn't hard to find me. All you needed to do was walk up the street, and two blocks away, poof, you're right in Toyland. You're at a football stadium, you got basketball courts, tennis courts, just an incredible experience.
The greatest quarterback in South River High School football history, and my first quarterback in high school with Joe Theismann.
Drew Pearson went on to play against Theismann in the NFL, With Dallas, he became one of the greatest clutch receivers in NFL history. But the first pass he caught in high school was from Theismann.
The pass was a 60-yard touchdown, and I caught it standing in the end zone. And Joey was scrambling to his left when he threw the ball. Now, I played with Joey not only in football. In baseball, he played shortstop. I played second base. In basketball, he was the backcourt. I was part of the backcourt with him. We used to call him the black hole, okay? When we threw him the ball, we never got it back, okay? And he knew that. He knew we were calling him that. He still hold it and shoot, okay? But that was Joey.
My whole life was athletics. If my mom was looking for me, all she needed to do was walk out the front door, turn right, and start walking up towards the high school. And when my mom got up there, she'd yell, "Joey," and I'd be on one of the fields. This is the stadium where it started, the South River Rams. Everything you could possibly want as a kid is right here. Get myself ready to play football and then come out here and just play till dark.
South River High School here. The old field I used to play on, trying to find my old quarterback.
I mean, we used to.
Not Roger Staubach, I'm talking about Joey Theismann. Let's sneak around this way a little. How little. Does he know? He's got eyes, but not in the back of his head.
That it still remains.
Hey! Anybody want to play some catch out here? Can anybody find me a quarterback that can throw to me? Anybody out here want to play some catch?
What are you doing?
With an old wide receiver?
How are you?
All right. Jesus. Good to see you, man.
Did you come in for that? You look great.
You look great yourself. Hey, I had to come here to surprise you like this.
I'm telling you
and
something.
I wouldn't be the receiver I was in the day if it wasn't you thrown to me earlier in the day. First pass I caught was a 60-yard touchdown from this guy.
I know.
I'm standing in the end zone right there.
And I'm telling you, what's really funny is I watched you, obviously, in high school. That's how you are. When you played all those years of professional football.
Right.
I'll root for you 14 weeks a year when you were a Cowboy, okay? Being that we're on the field here, why don't we relive an old memory?
Let's do it.
Your first,
one
of mine.
Let me take my rings off first, okay?
Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry.
Let me take my rings off first.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Tito, can you hold these?
I love you, man.
Oh, it's all good. Let's do this, all right?
All right, here you go.
All right.
This is a stroll down memory lane. You ready?
I'm ready,
You look the same out there. Run that post for me, okay?
The former teammates are in their 70s. And while there may not be spring in their step, there is joy in their hearts.
Touchdown, South River High School, Denny Field.
Thank
Still
you.
Connecting. Connecting big time.
Do that thing. Do it again.
You got a great arm. You still got it.
There it is. Boom. There it is, right there. There you go. Careful. Careful. Thank you.
You still got it, bro.
Thanks for coming. So much.
Don't take no pictures. Cowboy and the Redskins hugging like this. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. What the world's going to come to?
Both organizations will.
The Democrats and Republicans might even come together.
Anyone who looked at Little Joe Theismann growing up in South River didn't see a professional football player.
I mean, I graduated from high school, I was 152 pounds. Who was gonna look at me?
Yeah, well, he wasn't that big, you know? But see, what was big was his heart and his ego, all right? You could not keep Joey down.
I wound up having a really good senior year, and we were undefeated.
Our high school coach ended up getting an assistant coaching job at North Carolina State. Joey's about to go there. Then all of a sudden, Notre Dame calls. When Notre Dame called, it was all over. All right, if Notre Dame wants you, you gotta go.
I remember going out to the university and then flying back and getting off the plane in Newark, New Jersey. My dad picked me up, he says, "What do you think?" I said, "I have to go to Notre Dame." He says, "Why?" I said, "Dad, I can only tell you this, it feels right."
The spirit of Notre Dame is, I think, if it could be bottled, could probably light up the universe.
So my freshman year, Johnny Ray is the linebacker coach, Joe Yonto is the defensive line coach. And Johnny says to Joe, "Where's this hot shot quarterback you got?" He says, "That's him over there." He says, "Oh my God, he doesn't look big enough to carry a water bucket. Are you kidding me, Joe?"
In 1968,
Theismann and Coley O'Brien were backups to starting quarterback Terry Hanratty when Joe got the chance he had been waiting for.
Irish fans are apprehensive because of the loss of Terry Hanratty, who will be out for the rest of the year. Coach Ara Parsegian is forced to hand the Irish offense over to number 7.
Ara could have gone to Coley. Coley had the experience. Coley won a national championship. He goes to me, he said, "You're in." That's a very defining moment in a young athlete's life. You can go one of two ways. You can act like you belong, or you can act like it's too darn big. I just stepped in the huddle and I said, "Hey, let's go get it done."
Young Joe Theismann starting at quarterback.
6 feet tall, 170 pounds, from South River, New Jersey. And what pressure is on this young man?
Theismann took over and never looked back, setting Notre Dame career records for touchdowns and passing yards.
The poised quarterback gives the impression he wants to become a veteran in one game.
In his senior year, the Irish quarterback led Notre Dame to a Cotton Bowl victory.
He's a willowy boy, 6 feet, 170 pounds, but remarkably quick feet and excellent balance.
The South River Roadrunner, one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time.
The beginning of my senior year, Roger Valdeseri, our public relations director, calls me in the office. He said, "Joe, how do you pronounce your last name?" I said, "It's Theismann." He said, no, your last name is pronounced Theismann." I said, no, my last name is pronounced Theismann." He said, "No, Joe, your last name is pronounced Theismann." He said, "Joe, I want to tell you something. There's a trophy out there called the Heisman Trophy. It's the best college football player in the country. We think you have a chance to win that trophy. But we're not just going to count on your athletic ability nor the reputation of the University of Notre Dame. But we think by just simply changing the pronunciation of your last name from Theismann to Theismann to rhyme with Theismann, we can get you that trophy." And that's how my name was changed. And that's how I became Joe Theismann. It was really the first time, I believe, that any university had put together a public relations campaign to have somebody win the trophy. There were Theismann for Heisman buttons and Theismann for Heisman bumper stickers. I mean, had all kinds of stuff. I didn't win the Heisman Trophy. Jim Plunkett won it, deservedly so.
The 36th winner of the Heisman Memorial Trophy. Congratulations and good luck.
Thank you very much.
I've had a call from Joe Theismann. He's waiting to hear from you, and I have the number, and I hope that you'll find time to call him back. He's waiting to hear from you to congratulate you, too.
He finished second to Jim Plunkett, but Theismann or Theismann, it didn't matter. Professional sports teams were all interested in Joe.
I wound up being drafted by Miami in the fourth round. I was drafted by the Toronto Argonauts up in the Canadian Football League.
Theismann began negotiating with head coach Don Shula's Miami Dolphins.
I didn't have an agent. So I fly down to Miami, walked into Mr. Robbie's office, sat down, and he said, "What do you want?" And I said, "I want $35,000, $45,000, and $55,000, and I want a $35,000 signing bonus." He said, "You got it." Shula thinks I'm signed, sealed, and delivered. And they sent me my contract. And they put a clause in the bonus that said, if I didn't show up for any of those years, the bonus would have to be repaid. Now, keep in mind, in 1971, we were at the end of the Vietnam War. So I didn't know what was going to happen. So I said, no, this isn't right.
So Theismann signed a contract with the Toronto Argonauts.
Don flew up to South Bend and read me the riot act. You had a moral obligation to be a Miami Dolphin. I said, "Well, you had a moral obligation not to screw with my contract." They had actually changed it to the way I wanted it, but I became so disillusioned with the process that I said, "To heck with it." And so I wound up being a Toronto Argonaut.
A lot of people call me cocky. I don't mind. I think there's a very, very fine line between cockiness and self-confidence, and I hope to elude self-confidence because I don't think there's anybody better than I am.
Theismann fit right in Canada, becoming a fan favorite and media darling.
You're gonna move, try and go straight up and look to it over your left outside shoulder, right?
Theismann stayed in Toronto for 3 years and led the Argonauts to their first Grey Cup appearance since 1952. The Dolphins, they won 2 Super Bowls.
You know, it's like I look at the years the Dolphins won Super Bowls, the undefeated season in 72.
Shaking up on the play is Greasy.
Yeah, it looks like his right ankle, Rick. It may be right here. He may have to go out of the ball game.
In the middle of their quest for perfection in 1972, quarterback Bob Greasy was sidelined. the Dolphins turned to backup Earl Morrill, who led Miami to victory in their 9 remaining regular season games.
They had to go get Earl Morrill because I didn't go. How do you feel now? Bob Greasy's hurt. You would have had an opportunity to be the quarterback of the Miami Dolphins.
The Dolphins have completed the greatest season in NFL history.
Had I not gone to Toronto, the Miami Dolphins would have never signed Earl Morrill, which theoretically could have been me. So from my perspective, to all the Dolphin fans, about those early years in the 70s that they went to Super Bowls, I accept your thank you.
In 1974, Joe Theismann found a new team after Washington head coach George Allen traded a first-round draft pick to the Miami Dolphins, who still held Theismann's NFL rights.
When I came back to the National Football League, I happened to come to a football team that had 2 very old quarterbacks. Bill and Sonny were in their late 30s, and I figured this is an opportunity to spend 2 or 3 years learning from people like that and being with a winning organization, the Washington Redskins, and, you know, I had everything mapped out very, very well. Little did I know that both of them would become the Rock of Gibraltar when I got here.
I came to town, and at my press conference said, I didn't come here to sit, I came here to play. Well, that pissed them off. And so rumor has it that they were out together having a few, little bit of libation, and they sort of made a pact that it didn't matter which one of them played anymore, as long as he didn't, me being the he. And so it was an uncomfortable quarterback room for a while.
Despite the friction with 40-year-old Sonny Jurgensen and 35-year-old Billy Kilmer, the 25-year-old quarterback did everything he could to get off the sideline.
He was hungry. And a lot of the veterans looked at him as being a little bit of a hothead because he was out there doing everything that he could to be seen. He wanted the coaches to know that he wanted to play. He even volunteered to be the punt returner. Sonny and Billy really thought he was just showing off.
Theismann spent his first 2 seasons on Washington's special teams unit.
I had great confidence in my ability to play, but I wasn't the most patient person in the world. That's why I return punts. I kid these guys today with these 6 and 7 yard averages. They run 4.3, 4.4s. I said, I'm a 4.7 guy, and I got a 10 yard average.
Pro football was not on the docket 365 days a year. But in Washington, Joe could keep it going throughout most of the offseason. Joe Theismann was everything that we would see later then. At a young age, when the Redskins weren't any good yet.
I opened a restaurant as a third-string quarterback. Yeah, I opened my first Joe Theismann's restaurant in 1975. I gave myself a year to get settled in.
Joe knew that his name meant something, that people respected it. That was part of his confidence, that he was going to be the starter. He was going to be the name. He was going to have a name that everybody would want to be around.
In his 5th year in Washington, Theismann became the starting quarterback. Over the next 3 seasons, he won 23 games, but Washington never went to the playoffs. Then, in 1981, they got a new coach.
The first year under Coach Gibbs, it was an interesting time. I'm not Joe's. I'm not his. My personality with anybody, it seems like it has to grow. Ask my wife. She'll tell you. It's just, I either grow on you or you grow on me. It sort of works that way a little bit. We used to sit in meetings. Now, keep in mind, our meeting started at 7:30 in the morning. Joe had been up all night.
I could hear him come down. Some of them would be boom, 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 into the meeting room. And so I knew when Theismann was coming because his steps outside, which I could hear, and it would be boop, 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 in the room. And he'd immediately start talking.
I'd be at the end of the hall going, hey, coach, how's it going? He would turn around, he would look, and he would walk right back in his office for another 15 minutes because he just couldn't deal with me at that particular time of the morning.
Gibbs and Theismann weren't clicking in 1981, and it showed on the field. Washington lost its first 5 games.
Theismann looking over the middle, and this is picked up.
Theismann's mad at himself. He shouldn't have thrown that one.
Our team is our quarterback and our head coach. Those two people have got to kind of be lockstep. Joe has said the story. He went to Joe Gibbs and said,
Coach, we need to talk.
And I get a knock on the door, and I go to the door, and it's Joe.
I'm sure he was the most shocked person on the face of this earth at that time. So we sit down, and I said, look, man, I want to be your quarterback, but I get the sense that we're not on the same page.
He came in, and what resulted from that meeting, I think, is one of the most important parts of our relationship, and certainly as we went forward with the Redskins.
He said, I need 100% commitment from you. You have restaurants, you have TV shows, you have all these outside interests. I said, I'll get rid of all of them. If that's what it takes for me to prove to you that I want to be your quarterback, I'll get rid of them. But before you do that, give me a chance. Give me a chance to prove to you that I can be the guy.
Joe Theismann bringing the Redskins out of the huddle and up to the line of scrimmage. Dan Henning, the offensive coordinator, told us yesterday that Theismann is the most prepared and most motivated quarterback that he has ever been associated with.
Theismann ended the 1981 season with then career highs in attempts, completions, and yardage. After the slow start, quarterback and coach led Washington to wins in 8 of its final 11 games. Joe and Joe had found a groove.
All NFL training facilities will be struck. We are prepared to withhold our services however long it takes.
Washington was 2-0. When a strike temporarily shut down football in 1982, Theismann was forced to lead in a different way.
Just because we're on strike didn't mean that we had to stop practicing. And so we would go to a local high school. He would call up the receivers and everybody and say, hey, this is where we're going to meet. He kind of orchestrated everything.
To the guy's credit, I took the last game plan we had. I'd get them together, and we'd all get out there. And we had, like, 35 guys. It was going to end. Inevitably, we knew that. But we wanted to be ready when it happened.
Football resumed after the 57-day work stoppage, and the regular season was reduced to just 9 games.
When the season started back up, we just kept rolling. And it was because of Joe's leadership.
Washington was 5-1. When the rival Giants came to town, and Theismann delivered one of the gutsiest performances of his career.
55 left in the third quarter. Look at that. Who is that man? Byron Hunt.
He came in like a runaway dump truck that time. Nobody got a shot at him.
When he got to the sideline, I look at him, his two front teeth, they're knocked out. They're in half. He is spitting blood. He is ranting and raving. There was nothing about being hurt or anything else.
255 left. Here's a fake draw, a fake screen, and the pass wide open.
In the fourth quarter, Joe Theismann, with front teeth knocked out, led us on a 65-yard drive. We won that game.
He got a block from Theismann. He's to the 5. He's to the end zone. Touchdown.
I think that's when the players really started to rally around Joe as their leader, the catalyst that was going to take us to wherever we were going.
Joe, where are you going after you take your shower?
What's that? I have to go to the dentist, Jack. That one blitz that came from the right side knocked my two front teeth out.
Can we zoom in on you? Would you mind?
I don't know. You want to zoom in on him here? Bring in the camera. I'll show you.
Now, there goes his TV career.
He was a tough SOB. People can think they were tougher than Joe Theismann. They were not. Joe wasn't maybe the most popular guy 7 days a week. I'm not going to sit and make the case he was Tom Brady, but he had the respect of him on Sunday.
Theismann dominated Sundays in 1982 like he had never done before. Washington was the class of the NFC.
Far side, touchdown!
We really hit a groove. I mean, we really did. Like I said, we just felt like we got better and better and better and better. Then all of a sudden you get to this moment.
As the Dallas Cowboys are in town for the NFC Championship against the Washington Redskins. And this town and these fans have gone Redskin wild.
Everybody's screaming, we want Dallas, we want Dallas. Pounding their feet on these aluminum seats. And the ground beneath, I'm getting goosebumps right now. The ground beneath my feet is shaking. I get this question asked often. What's the most memorable game you ever played in? Obviously, people expect me to say, the Super Bowl was an incredible experience. Winning the Super Bowl is nothing like it. But standing in that stadium, it's the Dallas Cowboys, truly our hated rivalry. It's a chance to go to the Super Bowl, which is a lifetime experience for anybody. And here we are ahead. And it's like, holy mackerel. That, to me, is the most memorable game in my entire career.
Theismann to throw. First down throw. Theismann chased. Gets away from a couple of Cowboys. Still on his feet. Ed Jones in his face. Pass complete. Theismann back to throw again. Good protection again. Pass complete again.
Theismann was heading to his first Super Bowl at the age of 33. Waiting for him was the same team and coach he spurned 11 years before.
We've worked harder than anybody to get here. Nobody can beat us in a team, and it's worth $70,000 and a big break.
Washington trailed for three quarters in Super Bowl 17.
Let's go. Goal line, eye left, tight wing, 70, chip on white. Ready?
Here comes the diesel. Here comes the diesel.
John Riggins' signature fourth quarter, fourth down run put them ahead for good.
He's got the first down to the 40. He's gone.
But Riggins doesn't get that chance. Had it not been for Theismann's heads-up play earlier in the half.
We were down, I think we were down by four at that time. We were backed up in our own end, and we called a quick hitch.
Theismann batted in the air. Almost a touchdown for Campbell Camper. Oh, my.
I see the ball go up in the air, and I don't know how many people have experienced this, but my world went into slow motion. My feet felt like they were in cement, and it was like, I've got to get to the ball.
Joe Theismann playing defensive back on his own pass. Now watch Theismann go up and knock it out of the hands of Kimbo Camper. Kimbo Camper said, it was my touchdown.
Great play by Theismann. As it appeared, Bo Camper indeed had six.
And we're sitting in the end zone, and I looked at him, and I went, that was close.
Theismann's first and only pass breakup of his career set up the first Lombardi Trophy of his career.
For the first time since 1942, the Washington Redskins have an NFL championship.
Winning a Super Bowl changes your life. People don't walk around saying, hey, remember that other team that played in the Super Bowl? They remember the people that won it. People say, what's it like to win a Super Bowl? It's almost indescribable because it's an experience that you have in your life that very few people are able to go to.
After winning Super Bowl 17, Washington may have been even better the following year.
83 was one of the greatest football teams in the history of the National Football League.
Joe Theismann has had a great year.
Best team I've ever played on. I think the 83 team may have been the best team that Washington's ever put on the field.
Joe was the MVP. Joe was the best player in the league.
That was a perfect throw by Theismann.
We lost two games that year by 1 point. We were the highest scoring team in the history of football, 541 points. We entered games where I didn't question whether we would win or lose, but only how many points would we score.
The NFL's most valuable player led his team back to the Super Bowl against a Raiders team that they had already beaten earlier in the season.
We're playing in our second Super Bowl against the Raiders. So we're in the first half.
And I walked to the sideline, and I said, what do you want to run?
And I kind of made up my mind, we're going to go for it, at least take a chance.
Again, this is not a conversation. This is not a debate. This is an order. I want to run rocket screen.
So I called an under screen to Joe Washington.
I started walking away. I get about 5 yards away. I turn around. He points to me. He goes, run it. Now I'm jogging on the field going, I don't feel good about this.
Theismann back. Looks off to the left, and he fires it out there. Intercepted. Jack Scorer. Touchdown, Raiders. I don't believe it.
And they looked like they knew it was coming. Man ran right for it.
Fast forward 5 years, and I walked up and says, Coach, I got a bone to pick with you. He says, what's that? I said, you know that screen you called in Super Bowl 18, that rocket screen? I said, that's one of the worst calls you made. He said, it may be, Joe, but I'll tell you, that pass of yours, one of the worst I've ever seen.
I would leave him a note whenever I saw him, and I said, why in the heck would you throw that? And he would always leave me a note back to me, and it says, why in the hell did you call that?
Washington lost the game, but the NFL MVP's popularity was higher than ever.
Canon's AE-1 program is impressing a lot of people. For the pro photographer,
it's even more advanced.
And for pro quarterback Joe Theismann,
it's even simpler to use.
Joe's always on TV.
He was that kind of guy. He liked being in the spotlight.
I don't think anybody in our locker room actually thought of him as Clark Gable or the, quote, leading man. But I bet you Joe did.
Hey, Sugar.
Yeah?
What have you got under the hood?
Well, that's a 454, four on the floor, full house with a blower.
Yeah?
She's a sweetheart, isn't she?
Mm-hmm.
Despite his fame off the field, Joe was becoming infamous for some of the plays he made on it.
We're playing the Chicago Bears, third game of the season, 1985.
And our punter gets hurt. And Theismann, here's his reaction. Put me in, I'll punt the living snot out of this thing. Hey, I'm ready.
He says, you what? I said, I can punt, man. How hard can it be? Drop the ball, raise your foot, boom, got it, piece of cake.
I said, Joe, get in there.
I'm no longer quarterback Joe Theismann. I'm punter. I got this punter thing in my mind.
He punts this ball. I swear to you, it would just spiral straight up in the air. And the bottom line is, it was a one-yard punt. Okay, now I'm ticked off. And he kind of looks at me and he went like this. He went, huh? And he goes to the bench. And I went, what?
Programs! Redskin programs!
Redskin point! Point!
7 weeks later, on Monday Night Football, the whole world witnessed the play Theismann is most famous for.
When I come back here, it's like the night is, it's as vivid as could be.
I remember the night like it was yesterday. I'm having this heart-to-heart with myself because I'm not playing well. We're 4-5, and I'm staring at my locker, and I'm thinking, you know, Joe, it's Monday Night Football. This is your, my favorite word is opportunity. This is your opportunity to be able to go out and show the world that Joe Theismann you love so much is back. Once again, a me moment for me. And then I'll never forget getting up from my locker and saying, the saying was real simple. Tonight, your life's going to change. We turn to start the second quarter, and Coach Gibbs calls a flea flicker.
First and 10. Riggins, flea flicker. Back to Theismann. Theismann's in a lot of trouble. And it was Lawrence Taylor who slammed Theismann to the ground.
And all of a sudden, I felt the pressure coming from the left side, and it was Lawrence. And so I tried to step up a little bit, and then he came around and caught my right leg between the knee and the ankle, and right out to the left, and I can hear it like it was yesterday. I hear this pow, pow. Sounds like two muzzled gunshots.
I knew that something was really bad when Lawrence Taylor leaped to his feet and beckoned over to the Redskins bench. Get your medical team in here quickly. It could be, and you hate to think of it, he could have hurt a snap.
You grabbed me.
Yeah, so. And
you swung around. And right here, right off my right ear, I heard this pow, pow.
I heard it too. I heard it too.
I mean, you were like, from the video, I mean, you were like incredibly concerned.
Well,
I appreciate that.
I was concerned because, you know, even though we were, you know,
rivals
and stuff, I had a lot of respect for you.
Thank you.
No football player likes to have that happen, particularly Lawrence Taylor. He plays this game as clean as anyone can play it. He is visibly upset.
You know, we don't go out there to hurt people.
No.
But when I did go and hurt it, and then I saw your leg, I got a little queasy.
Yeah, you saw it, though. Yeah, you saw the leg, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. It was a good one.
It was a good one. Man, I remember laying there, and, you know, Bubba comes out. Bubba Tires right here in my ear. And first thing I said to him, I says, call my mom. As the first person I saw, call my mom, tell her I'm okay.
You're not dead, you're just injured.
Yeah, but you know what? Your mother's worry. You know that.
The coolest thing I like, though, when they're about to cut you off, and you said, LT, I'll be back. I said, yeah, but not tonight.
They're going to be tonight.
Not tonight.
I know.
And now there's an ovation for Joe Theismann, who I am sure has played his last play of the 1985 season. I just hope it's not his last play in football.
That was a clock up there. And I remember laying on the ground, and I remember looking up, it was like 10:05. The one thing I saw, I looked up, and there, it's like time had stopped.
Usually I get my work done before 10, okay?
so we owe you for overtime, is that it?
I don't watch it.
I've seen it.
I don't
the
watch
last,
it.
The last time I saw it was almost 20 years now. I sat down, looked at it, and as I watched it, as it got towards that second quarter, my stomach started getting a little more queasy. That's the last time I've seen it. So I've seen it once in, what, 37,
yeah,
36 years?
Yeah, I don't watch it.
The pain is more than I've ever gone through in my life, as in any phase of my life, whether it be athletics or hitting myself with a hammer.
People come up to me and go, tell me, did it hurt? I look at them and I go, let me explain it to you this way. Go hang your foot off a curb. Let me go drive my car over your leg, and then you tell me if it hurts. That next morning, people were outside with signs, thank you so much, and you feel so humbled. You feel so appreciative of what the fans did in the fan mail, and I answered every one of them. I remember the nurse coming in Tuesday morning, okay? The nurse comes into my room. She says, Mr. Theis, Mr. Taylor's on the phone. Would you like to speak?
Yes, that's true.
He said, hey, Joe, how you doing? I said, not very well. He said, why? I said, why? You broke both bones in my leg, for crying out loud. He said, Joe, listen, man, I don't do things halfway. I got to go to practice. I'll talk to you later. You look at the things, you know, the things that you accomplished in the game, they sort of get overshadowed by this one thing that happened between us. I know in my career, it's the same thing. You know, you win a championship, you're an MVP of the league, you're all these things, but the only thing that people remember you for is an injury. I shouldn't say the only thing, but predominantly people...
You was MVP too?
Also. I was. Well, people say, do you see Lawrence often? Yeah, we see each other every now and then at different times.
Yeah.
I said, the one thing I won't let him do is stand to my left side where I can't see him. It does bring back memories out here, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's good.
This is sort of, I guess you could say, a culmination of so many things I enjoy and, you know, the peace and serenity of a fountain, the quiet. I mean, I love at night sometimes to come out and just sit quietly. It's just so peaceful.
Joe absolutely reminisces about the old days, mainly the glory days.
I guess you could honestly say that Lawrence and I have always been connected together, and I figured, why not have him in a very prominent place in a room that I absolutely love, and it sort of chronicles the history of my game, it chronicles the history of my life, and no one has had a greater impact, I guess you could say, on my life when it came to the world of athletics than Lawrence Taylor.
Give us a way out, will you please?
Joe Theismann's catastrophic injury forced the Washington quarterback to face the end of his playing career.
I didn't believe it.
I didn't care what the doctor said. I didn't care what anybody said. In my mind, I wasn't done. In my mind, I just needed a little more time to get a little bit more healthy.
8 months later, Washington released the former MVP.
My career didn't have a chance to really wane a whole lot when I got hurt. All of a sudden, I was gone.
For the first time since his youth, Theismann was unable to play football.
All year long.
But he had discovered something during his playing days. He had a knack for television. His first foray into the broadcast booth came nearly 10 months before his injury, when he called Super Bowl 19.
Joe, got to be some big butterflies going down there, and particularly the two quarterbacks.
Well, there's particularly one quarterback with big butterflies. He's sitting right here, right now.
It sort of wet my whistle for broadcasting.
Theismann was the guy that was most notably going to go right into the booth and be great at it.
By the way, Joe, you're not thinking about playing again.
Jack, I think about it every day. I don't miss Monday through Saturday, to be perfectly honest with you, but on Sunday afternoon, when you start to put on the uniform, and when I see these guys come out and warm up, it starts to beat a little bit hard inside.
When I got into broadcasting, people used to say I talked a lot. It's what I did. It's who I was. Doesn't go into
a shell. Theismann turned his gift of gab into a broadcasting career that spanned more than 20 years, including appearing on Sunday night, Monday night, and Thursday night football.
I think all of us knew that that was going to be his future. A big part of his whole football career, as well as his after football career, has been his ability to communicate with people.
Joe Theismann and Lawrence Taylor together again, inviting you to watch the Giants and the Redskins on Thanksgiving night on NBC.
Yeah, it's been a while since we've been together, Joe.
Thank goodness for that.
You want a leg?
I'm okay. No, thank you very much.
It's amazing that Joe can still, he can laugh about that.
I played for 11 years. I really had become egotistical. I started believing that I was Mr. Special. What happened to me changed my perspective on life. It changed what I believe, my appreciation of other people. I believe what happened between Lawrence and I helped me become, hopefully, a better person. I can't imagine myself playing any place else. I was able to play in one city my entire career, which a lot of guys don't get a chance to do nowadays. The thing that was neat about this city, it's a city with a lot of different people, a lot of different quote-unquote celebrities. When we were winning, we were the toast of the town.
Boy, nothing like a game. Absolutely nothing like it.
When you look at the history in this city, where do you fit in? You hope that you were able to be a part of something very special, which I believe I was. I loved the game. I was, you know, a guy that had a chance to play with a great football team. I walk out on that football field and, man, those memories come back like yesterday. Every minute is so precious. What happens if he's blocked that? I really don't know. Who knows where Joe Theismann is after that? Who knows if there's a broadcasting career? What ifs get you nowhere? I don't really think about my legacy.
I know what you'd like people to think. You'd like people to say, like, you know, he was a tough guy. He worked hard. He cared about people. Those things are important to me. And if people want to look at me that way, I appreciate that. Obviously, you know, early in my career, I did a lot of talking. And I still do a lot of talking.